This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to worship at River Glen Presbyterian Church. We're so glad to be gathered together on this third Sunday in Advent, the Sunday when we light the joy candle. We all know joy, but when we hear the laughter of a child or we see a loved one's face light up, we know that joy suddenly more completely. And we all know love. But when we get to hug a friend, or when we hold our beloved's hand, we know love that much more deeply. And we all know God. But when we gather to be reminded of God's grace and God's blessings, God's promises, suddenly God is that much more significant. So let us worship Holy God, for we are together with God, never alone. We are the church, we are the community, we are the body of Christ. Welcome home.
Good morning. We're the Hume family, and we were just talking about all the things that we dream about these days as we think about the rose candle of joy for this third Sunday of Advent.
I dream of dance parties in the kitchen.
I dream of laughter that is contagious.
I dream of birthday candles and another beautiful year.
I dream of family game nights and dinner parties with friends.
I dream of homemade Christmas cookies and homemade family recipes.
I dream of skateboarding with friends.
I dream of every little thing that brings joy, and I know it comes from God.
So tonight we light the candle of joy, as a reminder that God's dream for this world involves all the end of all tears.
God's dream for this world involves a joy that overflows and is contagious.
So may this fire burn bright as it does. May we sing. May we dance.
May we laugh.
May we hold on to the people that we love.
And may we bring joy in a hurting world. And may it be an act of holy resistance.
Let us pray. O great writer, with a sky full of stars and a world full of flowers, there should be no end to our joy. And yet, instead of decorating our very beings with joy, we let it slip away like loose change. Instead of singing like Mary or dancing like David, we pass by remarkable beauty and love most days, unfazed. Forgive us and teach us the ways of children who laugh and dance and sing as if joy is the very thing that keeps them alive. May they have joy figured out. Gratefully, we pray. Amen.
Hearts on full night.
I'm thankful to my colleague, the Reverend Catherine Willis Pershey. She's the pastor over at First Congregational Church nearby in Western Springs, and she is going to bring us God's word today through the sermon. First Cong is also reflecting on those who dream this Advent. Let us pray. Creator God, scripture is flooded with dream-like images. The lion lying down with the lamb, justice rolling like a mighty river, swords being beaten into plowshares, the prisoner being set free, good news to the oppressed, and the whole world rejoicing. To our human ears, there are times when these words can sound like nothing more than a far-off dream, downplaying prophecy to fantasy. However, what we know is that to dream is to hope. And to hope is to imagine, and to imagine is to wonder, and to wonder is to believe, and to believe is to live and breathe your promised day. So give us the strength to listen as we dream, O God, for deep down we know your words are the very thing we need. Amen. Hear the word of the Lord from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 46 through 55. Mary says, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud and the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his descendants forever." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh, hi there. No, your TV screen did not freeze, thank goodness. I just wanted to show off my waiting room, which is an homage to a show called The Good Place. Now, those of you that have seen the show, let me assure you that nothing bad has happened to you, okay? I just wanted to start this way because since it's Advent, I thought it would be a good time to talk about waiting, which is something that is not easy for me to do.
You kids don't need a lecture on waiting. You do a ton of it already. You wait for class to be over. You wait to get a phone. You wait to get your phone back from your parents, for permission to use the car, to date, to speak, to use the bathroom, for crying out loud. Some of you may in fact be waiting for church to be over. Well, get used to it. It's estimated we collectively spend about, wait for it, 37 billion hours just waiting in line each year. Ho ho, that's a lot of waiting. In any other year, we might see lines like that or like this.
The line waiting to see Santa Claus stretched all the way back to Terre Haute. And I was at the end of it.
Merry Christmas. I like Santa.
Come on, boys, girls. Yeah. Come on, Santa. Ralphie shows us that we don't wait well. It's uncomfortable. The stress, impatience, and anxiety of that long line made the time seem longer and probably led to Ralphie blowing it with Santa later. Let's think about my waiting room. Do you remember how long I kept you waiting? Not even 10 seconds. But it probably felt like longer, didn't it? As I said, we don't wait well.
To find more patience, my inner nerd recalled the infamous pitch drop experiment. In 1927, a professor wanted to show some substances that appear solid are actually very sticky fluids. He filled a funnel with pitch, or tar, and cut the bottom of the funnel so that the tar would drip out over time. And since 1930, it's dripped only 9 drops, leaving enough pitch currently in the funnel to keep it flowing another 100 years.
And as you can see, that waiting has been a thrill.
The question is, did that science lesson really help me improve my waiting skills? If it did, I still don't seem to have any more patience. As you can see, I'm having a hard enough time counting the days down to Christmas.
And this pandemic has been
taking forever.
So I look to the Bible. And the word wait appears 141 times, not counting the synonyms you'll find in the original Hebrew and Greek. But it's not the number of times the word appears, it's the amount of waiting that people did that's inspiring. Noah's Ark landed after 150 days at sea. Mary carried Jesus in the womb for 9 months. Moses wandered in the desert for 40 years. Even Jesus had to wait before starting his ministry, and you and I are waiting for the coming of our Savior even now. This is just one long waiting game. I have to admit that waiting is probably what God wants us to do. He's using this time to get our attention so that we notice something or someone else in the midst of our suffering and realize that we're not alone. We start to accept that we're waiting exactly where we need to be. Kids, if you're watching this during the premiere, type all the things you're waiting for into the chat. Go ahead, I'll wait. Maybe you're waiting for Christmas, a new year, a break, a change, a vaccine. For some, we've been waiting a long time. Now, this is important. As hard as it is, we need to take our eyes off the things we're waiting for and look at things in the here and now. because here and now are where things like hope and expectation live. It's where our faith is active and works to prepare the way. This is a vigil. It's kind of like we're the longest running experiment. So even though we wait for the party and everyone wants to go, something happens to us while we're waiting. We change. And that's why the only moment that really matters is right now.
Take it from Mr. Rogers, as played by Tom Hanks in the movie It's a Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood. I know we've seen this clip at River Glen before, but I saw the movie in full last week and couldn't resist sharing. Pay attention to how this clip makes us wait.
Would you do something with me, Lloyd? It's an exercise I like to do sometimes. We'll just take a minute and think about all the people who loved us into being.
I can't do that.
They will come to you. Just 1 minute of silence. Thank you for doing that with me. I feel so much better.
See, it's that waiting that allows us to listen to ourselves and hear a voice that we often don't take the time for. So how well are you waiting? How long are you willing to go? How can you wait better? Remember that the best things come to those who wait and hope and prepare.
Good morning. The song you're about to hear is called Prepare Him Room. Can you name the Christmas carol that comes from? It's actually a favorite Lawson game this time of the year. Name the carol. Prepare Him Room. It comes from Joy to the World. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room, and heaven and nature sing. That title and many of the words of this song have struck me as such good things to ponder during this season of Advent. Sometimes we can find ourselves so busy at this time of the year that we don't allow a lot of space for Christ filling our thoughts and our minds and our souls. This song is a reminder to keep our hearts open, to maybe create a little extra space. There's a line in the song that has stuck in my head all week. Oh, our hearts, as busy as Bethlehem, hear him knock. Don't say there's no room in the inn. So while we wait, as Len was just talking about, and we try to appreciate the wait, we can also prepare a little extra room for Christ in our days. Just a side note, this was a family effort, no one in the room but family, which is why we are maskless. And you'll see my son Aaron on drums, and his friend Jeremy Bernstein who's on guitar, and you will not see him in the video, but they were very properly distanced all the way from Nashville, Tennessee. So please open your hearts to this. It's Prepare Hymn Room.
Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Every time I read this text, I can't help but remember the context in which I first preached on it during my very first year of ministry. 15 years ago, four members of a Christian peacemaking team were abducted in Iraq. Their presence in the Middle East stood in contrast to the United States' military involvement. Ultimately, three of the peacemakers were freed. The sole American, Tom Fox, was eventually killed by his kidnappers. As I anticipated lighting the rose-colored candle of joy, to preach about Mary's glorious song of praise, two statements weighed heavily on my heart. One was from Tom Fox, words he had written before setting out to Iraq. He wrote, "We are throwing ourselves open to the possibility of God's grace, bringing some rays of light to the shadowy landscape that is Iraq. We are letting ourselves be guided by something that is beyond rational, intellectual analysis. Gardens beneath which rivers flow can again be the dwelling place for the people of Iraq. Everyone whose government and corporations are playing a role in this land needs to throw open the book of their heart. They need to let their light run before them as they bring redemption to those in power who are seeking to rule from a place of fear, violence, and shadows. That truly would be the highest achievement." Those words struck me as remarkably relevant to the Advent season. The other statement was from a popular radio host who had this to say about the kidnapping. "Anytime a bunch of people that walk around with their head in the sand, practicing a bunch of irresponsible, idiotic theory, confront reality, I'm kind of happy about it. Because I'm eager for people to see reality, change their minds if necessary, and have things sized up." Those words gutted me. Honestly, I still haven't learned not to be gutted by polemics such as this. Only it dawned on me then, as now, that radio host might have actually been right about one thing. He called prophetic Christianity a bunch of irresponsible, idiotic theory. According to the standards of the world, Christianity is irresponsible and idiotic. And it is our most idiotic doctrines that help me weave my way back to a place where hope is real, peace is possible, and joy is again in the air. "My soul magnifies the Lord," Mary sings. Now here is a girl who is unmarried and impoverished, who has recently been visited by an angel with a very peculiar message. Mary had every reason to run screaming from this angel, every cause to consider him an angel of darkness, not a messenger of the Lord. But she doesn't reject God's ridiculous plan to inhabit her womb. She hurries to see her cousin Elizabeth, and she breaks into song. This great hymn of praise has empowered the oppressed and unnerved oppressors for millennia. Mary, who knows our Creator so intimately, she carries the Son of God. Dreams of a God who reaches down and touches the pain of God's people. This God lifts up the victims of economic poverty and political violence and draws them close, the way a mother hen gathers her chicks beneath her wings. And this God sends the proud packing, the powerful and corrupt kings who are fluent in the ways of violence and domination are deposed. The rich, who have hoarded the stuff of creation for their own purposes, are sent away with nothing to show for their greed. In these Advent weeks, we prepare to hear the Christmas story again, in all its foolishness and in all its glory. We remember that the King of Kings and Lord of Lords makes himself at home in swaddling clothes, in a manger. And the Magnificat proclaims that because of this, things are going to change. Oppression will give way to justice. Tears will flow into rivers of laughter. The high and mighty will be humbled, and a poor, unmarried mother will give birth to the Savior. At the same time that Mary sings her revolutionary anthem, though, nothing has yet changed on the surface. God's time is not our own. Mary claims that God has brought down the powerful from their thrones, but the Roman Empire still continues to dominate the Israelites in their own hand. Mary professes that God has filled the hungry with good things, but famine still plagues the peoples of the earth. How can Mary's very soul be bursting with glimmering joy when there is so much reason to tremble with fear and quake with sorrow? It's irresponsible. It's idiotic. And yet, I believe with my whole heart that every word of Mary's dream is true. The magnification of God that emanates from Mary's soul, that jeweled core of every human being, is deeply, radically, and eternally true. The joy of Christmas is all about entrusting ourselves to God's dream of redeeming creation. With the birth of this child, the trajectory of history shall be transformed. To be sure, things are not yet right. This much we are sure of. We believe that God created the world to be a garden of praise and life, not a den of pain and death. It isn't right that bodies deteriorate and die. Young people shouldn't be killed in senseless accidents. Neighborhoods shouldn't be dominated by guns. Waters shouldn't be polluted by toxins. And to put it plainly, pandemics should not exist. But God is moving. God is moving, and a pregnant young girl bears witness to the glory at hand. A beautiful change is in gestation. The final triumph of life over death is inevitable. The child developing within Mary, who causes John the Baptist to jump for joy within his mother's womb, will grow into a king whose reign is everlasting. And the words he will use to illuminate his mission at the beginning of his ministry are the same words we read from the prophet Isaiah. He is the Anointed One. He has been sent to bring good news. Indeed, he is the good news. Everything is going to change, all because God is enfolded into a human being. Intervention by incarnation. It may be irresponsible and idiotic to trust the impassioned dreams of a virgin and a prophet. Good. Blessed are we who are made fools for Christ. The same Spirit of God that came upon Isaiah and overshadowed Mary still moves among us today. The light is bright now, though we are still living in the darkness. Now we pray fervently for our struggling youth and our isolated elders. Now we petition anxiously for our loved ones to make it to the other side of this long, dark winter. And even now we rejoice. For through the lens of the Magnificat, we dream of roses blooming and justice flowing and a world restored to joy. So let us join our souls with Mary's to magnify the Lord. Amen.
Sign to you, a baby born in Bethlehem. Come and worship, do not be afraid. A company of angels, glory in the highest, and on the earth a peace among those on whom his favor rests. Come and worship, do not be afraid. My soul, magnifies the Lord. My soul, magnifies the Lord. He has done great things for me. Child is born, unto us a son is given. Let every heart prepare his throne, let every nation under heaven come and worship, do not be afraid. My soul magnifies the Lord, my soul magnifies the Lord. He has done great things for me, great things for me. My soul magnifies.
Friends, let us pray for the world and for the church. Creator God, we are in awe of you. We will never know how you manage to dream up mountains and valleys, freckles, dimples, and curly hair, a cool morning mist, the change of the seasons, or the magic of music. Your greatness is beyond our reckoning. Like Mary, we too shall allow our souls to sing and bless your holy name. May we live out this gratitude in love for our neighbor, working for justice for the poor and feeding the hungry. Give us joy that overflows into song. And even though we do not always believe in ourselves, we believe that our song is pleasing to you. We believe. Help our unbelief. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. O mighty one, save us. Save us from our fears, save us from our wrath, save us from desire for power and propensity for deceit. Save us from pandemic, from isolation, irrationality, despair, and illness. Rescue us with your healing touch. Comfort us with your unending compassion, and uphold us with your courage and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Hear us also as we pray together the words our Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Many hands make light work. Teamwork makes the dream work. If we all do a little, it adds up to a lot. We all know that we're better together, and we miss that togetherness during this time. But we know that together, we're still joined together with the Holy Spirit, and that God is with us. That's part of what Advent is about. One of the things we do better together is contributing to the PCUSA's joy offering. And every year at Christmas, we're given this opportunity to show the difference it makes more than just as individuals or more than just as single congregations, but all together as a denomination. And so we invite you to give to the joy offering. It supports colleges for people of color. It supports ministers and church workers who are in need. And it helps support future leadership for the church. So we ask that you would give generously. You can do so online, and then you can email Robert, our treasurer, treasurer@riverglen.org, and let him know the amount, or you can send checks to the church. We invite you this Christmas yet again to show the world the witness of the PCUSA by contributing to the joy offering.
Thank you for your gifts to the Christmas joy offering.
Thank you for giving to the Christmas Joy Offering and helping me and other pastors who have a need.
Thank you for believing in me, believing in Stillman, and thank you for your gifts to the Christmas Joy Offering.
And now, friends, as you go and as you shine God's light in the world, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father that will never let you go, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.